Subcommittee on Research and Technology will come to order. Without objection, the chair is authorized to declare recesses of the subcommittee at any time. And without objection, the gentleman from California, Mr. Sherman, is authorized to participate in today's hearing. Good afternoon, and welcome to this hearing entitled The Science and Ethics of Genetically Engineered Human DNA. And I believe we also would like to welcome Representative Abraham to his first Science Committee hearing. Dr. Abraham, we are happy to have you join the Research and Technology Subcommittee, and we look forward to having the benefit of your expertise. Now, in front of you are packets containing the written testimony, biographies, and truth and testimony disclosures for today's witnesses. I now recognize myself for an opening statement. Biotechnology, the engineering of genetic material in living beings and plants, has transformed modern medicine and agriculture. Rapid advances in biotech research have brought great opportunities for new medical treatments and products, and simultaneously have also raised questions about possible ethical implications and safety issues. Today we are here to discuss the science and ethics of the most recent and eye-opening developments in biotechnology, human genome editing. This research has been a major topic of news and editorials in recent months. New tools that allow a gene to be deleted, inserted, or replaced by a different piece of DNA are becoming more cost-effective and simpler to execute. In April, it was reported that for the first time, a team of Chinese scientists had attempted to edit the genome of human embryos. The report raised concerns for many scientists and policymakers about the safety and ethics of using these new technologies on human DNA. Many prominent scientists have called for a better framework to be developed for responsible use of the technology. I look forward to learning more from our witnesses today, who will provide an overview of the science behind these new technologies, help us examine the implications and risks, and explore what the next steps should be for building the right kind of framework for utilizing the technology. They will also help us answer how the United States can be a leader and provide scientific and ethical leadership in this arena. So I now recognize the ranking member, the gentleman from Illinois, for his opening statement.
Thank you, Chairwoman Comstock, for holding this hearing on the science and ethics of new gene editing technologies. I want to thank all the witnesses for being here today and look forward to your testimony. Although we're talking about gene editing technologies that are very new, it's important to mention that humans have been altering the genomes of species through selective breeding for thousands of years. And since the 1970s, it has been possible to directly manipulate DNA, which led to biotechnology revolution and significant economic growth. Then we had the Human Genome Project to sequence the human genome, and it was coordinated by the Department of Energy and the National Institutes of Health. The full human genome was sequenced in 2003, opening up whole new possibilities for diagnosing and treating diseases. One such pathway led to the invention of the CRISPR technology. Thanks to new gene editing technologies, which include CRISPR, we are able to add, remove, and replace DNA bases. They can be thought of as search and replace tools for DNA. They're incredibly powerful technologies that have the potential to transform the healthcare, energy, and agricultural sectors. Although new, these technologies were outgrowth of decades of fundamental research, some of which was supported by the National Science Foundation. We are here today because a Chinese research group recently published a paper in which they use these technologies to try to modify human embryos. That paper highlights scientific and ethical issues with these technologies, especially if they are being used to modify human germline cells as opposed to adult somatic cells. I look forward to hearing about the science behind these technologies, as well as how the United States can be a leader in addressing the safety and ethical concerns associated with them. I understand the National Academies has launched a major initiative around human gene editing technologies. In the 1970s, the National Academies played a similar role dealing with the then new biotechnologies, and I look forward to hearing more about what they're planning to do concerning these new gene editing technologies. I also look forward to hearing about some of the potential non-human applications. With that, I'd like to yield my remaining time to my colleague and neighbor from Illinois, Dr. Foster, who was very interested in this topic and helped to organize today's hearing.
Thank you, and I'd like to thank the whole Research and Technology Subcommittee, including their chair, Congresswoman Comstock, and Ranking Member Lipinski, for allowing me to join you here today. And similarly, I want to thank Chairman Smith and Ranking Member Johnson for agreeing to hold this hearing. And a very special thank you to the witnesses for taking their time out for this very important issue. It is rare that prominent members of the scientific community come together to warn our leaders of technological breakthroughs that our legal system and society may not be prepared for. And yet, this is exactly what appears to be happening with recent discoveries in genetic editing tools. As the last PhD scientist in Congress, I'm afraid I've served as sort of a lightning rod for many of these warnings, and I take them very seriously. I want to commend the National Academy of Sciences and the Institute of Medicine for the launch of their major initiative on human gene editing. And I want to make sure that Congress does everything constructive that it can to make sure that this is handled responsibly. There is the possibility of very great benefits from these new technologies, and what makes them really revolutionary is what they could mean for humans. For example, replacing bone marrow of someone suffering from sickle cell disease with a modified version of their own marrow with the genetic defect removed. However, if genetic modifications are made to so-called germline cells, these are sperm, eggs, embryos, then the modifications will be carried forward to future generations, which has implications that we need to carefully consider. We're on the verge of a technological breakthrough that could change the future of mankind, and we must not blindly charge ahead. Well, thank you, and I yield back my time.
I agree with Dr. Foster, and it's great to see that we have so many people here at this hearing. It's a very important issue that we really need to consider deeply. So I thank the chairwoman and the chairman of the full committee, Chairman Smith, for holding this hearing today, and I'll yield back.
Thank you. And I now recognize the chairman of the full committee, Mr. Smith.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I do look forward, as do the others, to today's discussion on a new development in biology, which has been called a game changer, revolutionary, powerful, and a major issue for all humanity. The new discoveries in genetically engineering human DNA offer potential cures for devastating genetic disorders, but the speed at which these new, simpler, and cheaper technologies are being used in the lab also presents ethical and health concerns. Most of the scientific community members have been clear. The science and ethics of this new technology must be resolved in order to prevent dangerous abuses and unintended consequences. A recent report from China, where teams of researchers have begun to experiment with engineering DNA in human embryos, is alarming. This is an area where the United States can and should provide scientific and moral leadership. We need to better understand the technology and procedures being used so that we can ensure patients are treated in the safest and most ethical manner possible. An April editorial in Science magazine called for a prudent path forward for genomic engineering. It recommended a moratorium on further research while creating public forums for scientists, ethicists, and policymakers to discover the to discuss the attendant ethical, social, and legal implications of genome modification. This is why it is important that the House Science Committee is holding the first congressional hearing on this profound and complex subject. The purpose of the Science Committee is to explore the significance of scientific discoveries as well as their potential implications for humankind. But we also must always be conscious of the potential ethical and moral issues raised by previously unimagined scientific breakthroughs. We must take the lead in reviewing new and innovative areas of science, such as genetically engineered DNA. So I look forward, Madam Chairman, to this informative discussion today, and we have an excellent panel of witnesses to hear from as well. And I'll yield back.
Thank you. And if there are members who wish to submit additional opening statements, your statements will be added to the record at this point. Now, at this time, I would like to introduce our witnesses. Dr. Victor Zhao is the president of the National Academy's Institute of Medicine and the James B. Duke Professor of Medicine at Duke University. Dr. Zhao has received many honors, including the Distinguished Scientist Award from the American Heart Association. He earned his undergraduate and medical degrees from McGill University and holds 8 honorary doctorates. Our second witness today is Dr. Jennifer Doudna. I can't get that right. Dr. Doudna is professor of molecular and cell biology and professor of chemistry at UC Berkeley. A member of the National Academy of Sciences, Dr. Doudna is the recipient of several awards, including the NSF Waterman Award and the 2015 Breakthrough Prize for Life Sciences. Dr. Doudna earned her undergraduate degree in biochemistry from Pomona College and her PhD in biological chemistry from Harvard University. I now recognize the gentleman from Illinois, Mr. Lipinski, to introduce our next witness.
Thank you. As a Northwestern University alumnus, I'm very excited to have Dr. McNally here today. To say it aside, Dr. Zhao, I also an alum of Duke University, and unfortunately for Dr. Doudna, alum of Stanford also. Dr. McNally is the director of the Center for Genetic Medicine and a professor in the departments of medicine and biochemistry at Northwestern University's Feinberg School of Medicine. She is a cardiologist who specializes in inherited forms of heart disease. Dr. McNally's research has identified genes and mechanisms for how genetic defects lead to heart and muscle disease. She has an undergraduate degree in biology and philosophy from Barnard College at Columbia University, and an MD and PhD from the Albert Einstein College of Medicine. My pleasure to welcome Dr. McNally to our committee and look forward to her testimony.
Okay, and our final witness is Dr. Jeffrey Kahn, the Robert Henry Levi and Rita Hecht Levi Professor of Bioethics and Public Policy at the Johns Hopkins Berman Institute of Bioethics and a professor in the Department of Health Policy and Management at the Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health. Dr. Kahn received his bachelor's in microbiology from the University of California, Los Angeles, his master's in public health from Johns Hopkins, and his PhD in philosophy and bioethics from Georgetown University. In order to allow time for discussion, we would ask that you limit your testimony to 5 minutes, and your entire written statement will be made part of the record. I now recognize Dr. Zhao for 5 minutes to present his testimony.
Good afternoon, Chairman Smith, Chairwoman Comstock, Ranking Member Lipinski, and members, subcommittee members. As you heard, I'm Victor Zhao. I'm the president of the Institute of Medicine, which will soon be named the National Academy of Medicine on July 1. I'm pleased to be here on behalf of the National Academies of Sciences, Engineering, and Medicine. The academies operate under a congressional charter signed by Abraham Lincoln to provide advice to the nation on matters where science, technology, and medicine can solve complex challenges and thereby improve people's lives. Thank you for the opportunity to speak with you today about this very important matter of human gene editing and the major initiative that we have at the National Academies launched to help guide decision-making in this area. The academies have an established record of leadership on advising on emerging and often controversial areas of science, particularly genetic research, such as recombinant DNA and stem cell research. Our initiative is marshaling the best scientific evidence, medical, ethical, legal, and other expertise to help you and the nation obtain a thorough understanding of gene editing and its potential risks and benefits. Our work is intended to provide a solid foundation to help inform decisions and policies on this research. As you will hear from other witnesses today, gene editing technology holds great promise. In fact, powerful new tools such as CRISPR-Cas9, developed by my colleague, Dr. Doudna, and others, as well as other genetic engineering technology, allow researchers now to precisely modify the genetic makeup of any living organism, including humans. The possible benefit application for such technologies are many. They could offer a cure to devastating genetic diseases such as Huntington's disease, as you heard, or sickle cell anemia. It can help improve and understand the treatment of many other illnesses. These technologies also present complex challenges, both to scientific and medical communities and to society as a whole. Of particular concern is the potential to make permanent modification to human DNA in nuclei of eggs, sperms, or human embryos that are then passed down to succeeding generations, known as germline gene editing. Research that attempts to alter the human germline raises important issues in many, so many different ways about safety, risk, social, economic, ethical, and regulatory considerations. So although more remains to be done before these technologies can be deployed safely, their availability certainly intensified this debate among scientists and physicians about such research. Here in the U.S., there are legislative prohibitions on the use of federal funds for research in human embryos, and there exist constraints on such research when it's subject to oversight by the U.S. Food and Drug Administration or other government agencies. These constraints, however, do not apply to work done internationally without federal funds and without the intent to seek federal approval of any products of that research. So clearly, we have reached a critical juncture in genetic editing research, and guidance is needed. The National Academies of Sciences, Engineering, and Medicine are prepared to provide that guidance based on an in-depth review of science underlying gene editing, the potential benefits, and the valid concerns raised by this research. Toward that end, our initiative on human gene editing research is already underway. Just last week, we held the first meeting of a multidisciplinary advisory group that will help us steer our initiative and ensure the Academy's efforts are comprehensive, inclusive, and transparent. Since much of this research is done internationally, the Academies will convene a global summit to obtain multinational perspectives on recent scientific development in human gene editing and the associated ethical and governance issues. Concurrently, we will appoint an expert committee to conduct a comprehensive study of the scientific underpinning and clinical, ethical, legal, and social implications of human gene editing. We hope that we will come up with recommendations which can inform the nation for decisions in this area. All of us, scientists, physicians, policymakers, and public, want to do everything possible to ensure that scientific and medical breakthroughs benefit all of mankind and do no harm. The Academies are certainly ready to help. I would be very happy to answer any question the subcommittee may have. Thank you.
And Dr. Dardenne?
Good afternoon, Chairwoman Comstock and the rest of the members of the committee. It's a great pleasure for me to be here and have the opportunity to talk with you about science that I've been involved with from its origin and am involved in leading the discussion of where it's going. I wanted to start by saying that this is research that originated as a basic science project funded in part by the National Science Foundation. We did not aim to develop a genome editing technology, but in the course of the experiments that we were doing, it became clear that what started as a study of a bacterial immune system, the way bacteria fight the flu, could actually be re-engineered and re-harnessed, really, as a technology for changing sequences in the genomes of cells and whole organisms. I wanted to tell you a little bit more about the science behind this to explain a little bit about how it works and why it's revolutionary. So I think what really makes this distinct from other ways of manipulating DNA in cells is that it's a very simple system. It relies, I would really make the analogy to software that you use for your computer. Here we have a protein called Cas9 that can be easily reprogrammed by using a short piece of nucleic acid called RNA that enables this protein to be directed to essentially any DNA sequence in the genome of an organism. And because genome sequencing has become very prevalent and is becoming less and less expensive, we have an exciting convergence of technologies that give us information about the entire genome in a cell or an organism, and now a tool that allows scientists to change that sequence in a very precise fashion. So we can do things, as was mentioned in the opening statements, like correct mutations that would otherwise lead to genetic disease. So this is, I think, a very exciting moment in biology. It's opened up a lot of opportunities for research, for clinical applications in the future. But it also raises various questions about the way that this technology should be employed going forward. And in particular, in our discussion today, the question of whether and when this technology should be employed to change the sequence in the human germline, in eggs or sperm or embryos, that would lead to a genetically modified person that would be a mutation that could be passed down to their children. And I realized fairly early on in our research that this technology was likely to be applicable in the human germline. And that led me to initiate a discussion initially with a fairly small group of scientists in California. We met in January of this year in the Napa Valley to discuss this very issue. And we spent a day, we had that small meeting included scientists, clinicians, as well as bioethicists, to discuss the various issues around human germline editing. And that meeting resulted in a perspective that was published in Science Magazine about 2 months ago that was referred to in the opening statements that called for a prudent path forward in any kind of clinical application of germline editing in humans. I do want to point out that our perspective favors research in this area. I think we feel as scientists that it's very important to have data so that we can make informed decisions about future potential applications. And I think this is many of us appreciate this is a technology that could be very helpful for people that have inherited genetic disorders. However, to ensure that any kind of application clinically in the human germline was safe and really was used in an ethical fashion, we do need to understand how this technology operates in those types of cells. Thank you.
Thank you. Now we'll hear from Dr. McNally.
Thank you. On behalf of Northwestern University, I'd like to thank Chairwoman Comstock and Ranking Member Lipinski for inviting me here today. I am Elizabeth McNally. I am the Ward Professor of Genetic Medicine, and I direct the Center for Genetic Medicine at Northwestern. I'm a cardiologist, and I specialize in providing care for patients and families with inherited forms of heart disease. Over the last decade, we've seen a dramatic increase in available genetic testing, and we now routinely provide genetic diagnosis, risk assessment, and importantly, risk reduction for genetic diseases that affect the heart. Diseases like cystic fibrosis, Duchenne muscular dystrophy, sickle cell anemia are those that are caused by mutations in single genes. The gene editing techniques that we are here discussing offer the opportunity for permanent, lifelong treatment of those disorders. With advances in DNA sequencing technology, it is now possible to sequence an individual genome in a day. For less than the cost of an MRI, a genome can be analyzed with high accuracy, pinpointing single gene mutations. The Office of Rare Diseases identifies nearly 7,000 rare diseases, and many of these are genetic in origin, often arising from single mutations. The ORD estimates that nearly 30 million Americans are affected by rare diseases. More than half of rare diseases affect children. Concomitant with advances in genetic diagnosis, there are parallel leaps in genome editing. CRISPR-Cas9 represents a significant advance for genome editing. Because of the co-development of gene editing and stem cell biology, there is significant potential clinical application. Induced pluripotent human stem cells can be made from blood, skin, and other mature human cells. For my field, cardiology, skin cells can actually form beating heart-like cells in a dish, allowing us to discern how mutations cause disease and letting us test how to correct these diseases. The human population is not placed at risk by these experiments in cells, and it seems fair to say that the human population would actually be harmed by not doing these experiments, since the research offers a potent opportunity to improve human health. Stem cells of the bone marrow, muscle, skin, and other organs can be isolated and edited. With these methods, it would be possible to cure sickle cell anemia or Duchenne muscular dystrophy. In mice, CRISPR-Cas9-mediated correction of fertilized eggs corrected the defect for Duchenne muscular dystrophy. The method, while imperfect, was associated with a remarkably high correction rate. Recently, a group of distinguished scientists called for careful consideration of gene editing in fertilized oocytes, fearing the potential for germline gene editing and ultimately human eugenics. These discussions were enhanced and prompted by the recent report, which we've heard about from Liang et al., which described the efforts using CRISPR-Cas9 in fertilized oocytes. A regulatory framework for gene editing should encompass several key points. It should permit research to optimize and improve CRISPR-Cas9 and related technologies. It should permit in vitro and cell-based gene editing technologies, including those in embryonic and induced pluripotent stem cells. It should permit in vitro and cell-based editing with the intent to reintroduce cells into humans as a therapeutic measure for somatic cells. And it should permit the generation of gene-edited animals for the purposes of scientific research. It may consider limiting or even prohibiting gene editing under the circumstances where human transmission of gene-edited germlines would occur. But would we ever really consider germline gene editing? So we should consider the scenario of pre-implantation genetic diagnosis, otherwise known as PGD. PGD is pursued by families to avoid transmitting genetic diseases. PGD involves in vitro fertilization coupled with genetic testing. PGD is not covered by insurance, and yet for some families, they make this choice. These may be families who are already struggling with caring for one disabled child and who cannot care for a second disabled child. PGD is a personal option and one that is made solely by parents and families. In principle, it is possible that the efficiency of genome editing will improve so that pre-implantation genetic correction could accompany PGD. With this process, gene editing to correct and eliminate a genetic disease could become reality. While the temptation may be to ban or limit this possibility, we should do so only with caution. Parents of children with genetic disease express significant concern, responsibility, and often dismay for having passed on mutations to their children. A parent's desire to protect children is undeniable. As a society and as a nation, we protect children. It may be tempting and easiest to ban gene editing where germline transmission could occur, yet the justified use of this approach is certainly conceivable and may one day be appropriate. Thank you.
Thank you. Dr. Khan.
Thank you. Chairwoman Comstock, Chairman Smith, and Ranking Member Lipinski, thank you for the opportunity to testify today on this timely and vitally important subject. As you heard in the introductions, I'm a professor of bioethics and public policy at the Johns Hopkins Berman Institute of Bioethics in Baltimore. Also relevant to my comments today, I am also currently chair of an Institute of Medicine consensus study commissioned by the FDA on ethical and social policy considerations of novel techniques for prevention of mitochondrial transmission in women to their offspring. Given that this study is considering issues related to the topic of today's hearing and the work of that committee is ongoing, I will restrict my comments to general observations and an overview of ethical and policy landscape related to gene editing. I'll focus my comments on three main topics. First, policy history in related areas of science and biomedical research. Second, ethical issues raised by gene editing technologies. And third, relevant existing ethical frameworks and approaches to oversight. The relevant policy history started in 1975, and we heard some mention of this earlier, with the Asilomar Conference on Recombinant DNA Molecules, whose summary statement focused on containment of the risks of creating and working with genetically modified organisms, and with the admonition to avoid experiments that, quote, pose such serious dangers that their performance should not be undertaken at this time, end quote. Along with a call for continuing reassessment of issues arising in light of new knowledge gained with the experience of the then new genetic technologies. And we've heard from Dr. Zhao that the national academies are effectively taking on this same role 40 years later. These voluntary suggestions that came from the Asilomar summary gave way to more robust oversight as the use of genetic technologies became more refined and with the initial attempts to treat diseases in humans. Should be noted that that's 40 years ago, and in the current environment, it would be very difficult for voluntary statements from a collection of even esteemed U.S. scientists to prevent research from going forward internationally, as we've seen already with the publication of the Chinese laboratory experiment. The ethical issues posed by gene editing and related technologies for modifying human DNA fall into three general categories of concern. First, the implications of the modification of germline DNA, and we've heard some about that already. Second, the implications of interfering in processes that should be off limits to humans, sometimes those are sort of generally termed playing God, and that's problematic in some people's minds. And third, the potential for selection or introduction of traits for other than treatment or avoidance of disease, such as physical or behavioral traits or even enhancements. The focus of much ethical analysis in the application of manipulation of genetic information in humans has been on changes that affect the germline, that is, changes that are heritable and therefore able to be passed on to future generations of individuals. The basis of these concerns relate to the uncertainty of the effects of genetic modification, the inability to undo unintended genetic changes or limit their effects, and the risks of passing on such unintended changes and their consequences to future generations, and that would, of course, go on forever. These ethical concerns have been addressed through a range of approaches in order to limit certain types of research or to provide prospective oversight prior to particular proposals being undertaken. We heard from Dr. Zhao that there are restrictions on federal funding of research that involves human embryos. Privately funded research is not affected by these restrictions, though the convention is that research on embryos should take place no later than 14 days after fertilization, and that's a limit also accepted by most countries engaged in research on human embryos. I should also note that there seems to be growing agreement that research should be restricted to non-viable human embryos. Then there are a number of institution-level oversight mechanisms that will apply to gene editing. That includes institutional biosafety committees, which are charged with overseeing research with recombinant or synthetic nucleic acid molecules, institutional stem cell research oversight committees, which are charged with, as their name implies, research on human embryonic stem cells and related areas of research, and as the technologies are introduced into human subjects, institutional review boards will be charged with overseeing any potential use on humans. Lastly, there is a role to be played by the scientific publication community. The journal publishers have an increasingly important role to play in setting and enforcing standards of behavior within the scientific community, since publication of findings in the peer-reviewed scientific literature signifies the endorsement of the community of researchers. Journals also play an additional critical role with requirements on the ethics standards being respected, assurances that authors' contributions are duly noted, and that human subjects are protected. So there's a role to be played on the part of the journal publication process that will restrict the potential of any unethical research going forward. Let me conclude by saying the U.S. has played a leadership role in this area in recombinant DNA and has the opportunity to do so going forward. There will be gaps identified in the process that the National Academies has set out on that need to be identified and addressed, and it is an appropriate time to consider what those ought to be. Thank you.
I thank the witnesses for their very interesting testimony. And now I remind members that committee rules limit questioning for 5 minutes, and the chair, as chair, recognize myself for 5 minutes. So I wanted to hear a little bit more, Dr. Downa, from what you mentioned, where you had initiated the discussion with the scientists in California and bioethicists and others to address this, and kind of some of the key, you know, maybe expand a little bit more on some of the key issues you found and how we avoid maybe where China might go and how we do define those boundaries and kind of what some of the concerns were that were raised, and if anyone else would like to address that too. But I thought I'd start with you and maybe expounding a little bit more on this group.
Sure, thank you. I think, you know, what was interesting to me in that conversation was that it was a wide-ranging discussion that started with sort of the way that we've been discussing this technology so far here in the committee, and eventually got to a point where somebody around the table said, you know, there may come a time when we would consider it unethical not to do editing in the germline for certain kinds of applications, such as some of the things that Dr. McNally mentioned. So I think that it's very important to appreciate that this is a powerful technology that is we're sort of looking at it here from the perspective of safety and ethical concerns. But I think they're also that can be turned around, and that was something that came out of our discussion in California that I found very interesting. And the other thing that that we discussed was the fact that this technology, unlike previous technologies for genome editing, is very simple to employ. relatively. I mean, it's something that, you know, people that have expertise in molecular biology can fairly readily use in their laboratories. So I think, you know, the real reality is that it would be very hard to really put regulations on this in terms of research applications. And I think that means that we just have to be thoughtful about providing leadership in terms of the, you know, the as Dr. Khan was saying, in terms of the way papers are published and reviewed among scientists, so that, you know, the scientific community helps to provide the kind of direction and, you know, vision for the way this should move forward that hopefully will be respected by many others. But I think the reality is that it, you know, it is a technology that's just very widely available now and is being employed worldwide.
I'd like to echo what Dr. Doudna said. I think we at the academies feel very privileged to be asked by the scientists. Ralph Cicerone, the president of the National Academy of Science, myself, got lots of phone calls and emails to say, you know, the academy really should take this on because we have done so in the past. As you heard, during the time of recombinant DNA at Sylmar conference, the human cloning, and also the whole issue of stem cell guidelines, as well as mapping the human genome. So we're happy to do this. I think that in the context of what's been discussed, it's really important that we have people from all different disciplines, not only scientists, but ethicists, legal experts, medical physicians, and others, all engage in this discussion. Because at the end of the day, what we want to do is to find what appears to be the consensus of what the right thing to do is for our country. And so we look forward to working on this.
So I would just like to echo what you've heard from my colleagues on the panel and add a little bit to expand on what I said about publication. It's difficult for the scientific community to identify any one thing that it can take on in an international way. But scientific publication knows no borders. And there have been calls now before publication of any gene editing research, that there be a disclosure of the ethics review that that research underwent. That did not happen, so far as we know, with the Chinese research that was recently published. And in fact, the reports have been that both Science and Nature rejected that paper when they considered it, and at least in part on ethics grounds. So that would be one way to create some framing of what would be acceptable as determined by the scientific community itself through the peer review process.
Thank you. And Dr. McNally, did you have anything to add? I have a few more seconds before I turn it.
I would also remember that through this process, it's not just the scientists and the physicians and the regulatory bodies, but to also remember the patient advocacy groups and the patients themselves. They're going to be the loudest voice in this process, and we need to hear what they have to say.
Thank you. Appreciate it. Now I recognize Mr. Lipinski for 5 minutes.
Thank you. I sort of want to follow up. I just want to make sure we're more clear on this and get into this subject. Dr. Doudna, you and the group that had met, so did you've called for a temporary moratorium on use of the technologies on human embryos. Is that correct? And I mean, what led you to that, and are there particular milestones in discussions or the science that you're working towards, and then see ending the moratorium? And I want to get the other panelists to comment on that.
So I would say what led us to that initial meeting in California was the appreciation that this technology would likely, you know, be functional in the human germline, and furthermore, that it was possible that people could do this fairly easily and perhaps working in jurisdictions where there would not be regulatory oversight of such experiments. And what was interesting was that at that meeting, we actually heard about the work that was subsequently published from the Chinese group. So it became apparent that the subject of that conversation was very timely. I think that, you know, going forward, we really have to appreciate the difficulty in putting in place regulations that will be, you know, followed internationally. On the other hand, providing oversight and leadership in by respected scientists in the U.S. and with our international partners, I think will be a very important thing to do. And that's really what we wanted to achieve at that meeting, was how to proceed with that sort of approach. And I think now having the national academies involved in organizing larger meetings around this issue is a very desirable outcome.
Does anyone else want to comment on a temporary moratorium on human embryos? Yes.
So the National Academy's position is that we need to be thoughtful, comprehensive, scientifically driven, and independent. So we are convening those bodies and obviously supporting the idea that we should be very cautious. We have not actually taken a position per se, because until our work is done, you know, we would be looking at what the most objective way to approach this when the work is done. So I think some of these meetings are critically important, important in the sense that we need international scientists to be involved with this conversation as well. We have, in fact, on our advisory board, scientists from Royal Society in London, scientists from the Chinese Academy of Science involved with this conversation, because it's really critical to consider all aspects. As Dr. McNagley pointed out, you know, if you use it in certain conditions, I think we have little doubt that this is going to be enormously helpful to patients and to mankind. The question is, what are the areas we need to be concerned about? That being said, I think technology is still early, because even if you look at a Chinese publication, they were looking at incomplete editing and many other issues that research has to go forward to understand the safety, the off-target effects, and the efficacy before human application. So that's our position.
Okay. Dr. McNally?
I would like to echo what Dr. Zhao just said, which is that I think I appreciate very much the leadership by Dr. Downa and the group of scientists that got together, but I think the IOM convening a international effort to really look at what the possibilities are, I would think it's reasonable to wait until we learn what that outcome is. It's important to have a careful and to have an international look at what the best recommendations really are at this point in time.
I'd just add very briefly that the kind of work people are talking about on an international level is really critical in establishing principles and guidelines for how to move forward. I think blanket moratoria, probably not what we need, but figuring out when we can go forward and how and under what kinds of restrictions. So certainly in vitro only, and probably for a very long time until it's determined that the milestones have been met in order to move forward into humans. So that's the good work that entities like the academies can engage in, and I think critical at the international level.
Thank you all very much. I think there are very difficult ethical questions we need to deal with here, and I know myself, I certainly don't know enough about the technologies, some of the specifics there, and I think that certainly makes a difference. And then we do get to a question, as Dr. McDaniel said, there are things that we certainly want to cure, and then the question always is, how far do we take this? But we're certainly not going to solve that here, so thank you very much.
Thank you. Now I recognize Mr. Molinar for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Madam Chair. And thank you for your presentations today, and my compliments to you on the work you're doing. It's very sophisticated, and it seems that it has tremendous potential for good. On the area of the ethics of this, I wanted to just explore a few different areas. Dr. Khan, I wanted to start with you. When you're advising on the ethics of a new genetic technology, are there certain ethical lines that should never be crossed? And if so, how are those lines drawn?
It's a great question, and how much time do we have, I guess, is going to be part of my answer. But, of course, those are the first kinds of questions that we ask. I will say there has been a longstanding line that has not been crossed, and that is modification of the human germline. That has held for decades. since the beginning of recombinant DNA technology was available and begun to be implemented. One thing that none of us have actually talked about is the Recombinant DNA Advisory Committee, which is a committee of the advisory to the director of the NIH, which has in its guidelines a statement that they will not consider any proposed research that modifies the human germline. So it's effectively a prohibition from that research going forward. Now, it only applies to research that is subject to the oversight of that committee, but that has been a bright line. The other thing which we've sort of skirted around but haven't maybe said explicitly is that when there's such uncertainty about the risk and the outcomes, we go slowly, right? So that's a kind of soft answer to your question, a mushy one, but I think that's an important principle to just to articulate in a way that's explicit. When we know it's time to go forward is a harder question, but we always start and ought to start slowly, especially when we're talking about potentials for modifying humans.
Thank you. And then Dr. Doudna, you're the one of the new developers of this new technology. And what was it that first sparked your concern over the ethics of its use, whether it was in China, or when did you start being concerned about that?
I guess I realized the potential for this technology to operate in the germline first when scientists began to do experiments of that nature in animal models of disease, including mice and rats. And then it really came home to me. It was last year, maybe almost a year and a half ago, that a group, again from China, published a paper in which they had modified the germline of monkeys and made genetically modified monkeys. And that actual monkey model is used very, very commonly for studying human disease. And so it seemed very likely at that point that there was no reason to think the technology wouldn't also work in the human germline. So, I think we've seen now in the scientific community that that this technology is very democratic in the sense that it works across many different types of cells. It doesn't seem to be limited to a particular system.
And what role does, I guess one of the things that occurred to me is the whole area of consent. What role does that play in this process when someone is giving consent or not?
Are you directing that question?
Yeah, actually all four.
I would defer that to Dr. McNally.
Well, as a member of an IRB for about 15 years, that's actually a, right now, consent in a research study in that case would be the parent, the mother would be the person providing consent. If a study were to go forward right now, that's who would be providing consent because it would be her materials that were being used for that purpose. So there isn't, from the standpoint of human subjects, strictly talking like institutional review boards, a fertilized egg is not an individual that provides consent. And also even, if it were a child, a parent provides consent for that, if that answers your question. Yeah,
thank you.
So I would sort of ask back, consent from whom and for what? So you've heard a version of the answer to that question. If we're talking about the donor of the materials that would be researched upon, that's a one set of questions. If we're talking about modifying an embryo that might one day be implanted into a woman's body and develop into a child, we have a very difficult conceptual problem. How do we think about consent on behalf of somebody who's not yet been born? And so those are the really interesting ethical questions that we will need to confront. We're certainly nowhere near thinking about doing that kind of application, but those are the kinds of questions that need to be identified, articulated, and addressed in efforts that are like the ones the academies are taking on.
I would agree with that. Thank you.
Thank you. Now I recognize Mr. Tonko for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Madam Chair. This hearing shines a light on a difficult but indeed important issue, and I appreciate my colleagues' focus on the ethical and legal issues surrounding this new technology. I'm also assured to see that experts in the medical and scientific community are coming together to debate this issue and to discuss potential policy implications. However, as we explore the boundaries of what science is capable of and what is ethical and what should be legal, we should also take a moment to appreciate just how remarkable these advances are. We recognize that these new gene editing technologies, including CRISPR, are the outgrowth of decades of fundamental research supported by federal agencies, including the National Science Foundation. So to Dr. Doudna and Dr. McNally, could you please speak to the importance of federal investments in fundamental research, especially the need to support research that may not have any known commercial application at the time?
Again, how much time do we have?
Reader's Digest version.
I think everybody sitting here at this table could say it cannot be overstated how important the federal investment is for research. There are many people who would love to see a lot of research funded in the private sector, but there are certain aspects of particularly fundamental research that will never be covered in the private sector. Sequencing the genome is a great example of that. And we can't move forward without that federal investment. And I think all of us here would say, you know, it's been fairly tough times in the last few years with what's happened with budgets and what's happened with research, and watching the effect that that has had on the scientific community here in the United States, where we have actually seen the size and shape of the scientific community shrink in the last few years, especially when we look across the world and we see it growing elsewhere. So yes, federally funded research is absolutely essential for these types of basic observations.
Right, so I echo everything that my colleague, Dr. McNally, just stated, and I want to also add that, you know, there's a tremendous opportunity for the U.S. to invest in basic science. I mean, I think traditionally our country has been a leader in science, partly because we have invested in science that was, curiosity-driven research. It was not necessarily targeted on curing certain diseases. And I think that we've seen again and again, especially, I would say, with regard to technologies, they tend to come from unexpected types of projects, such as the CRISPR system is a great example of that, but there are many others. And I think also it's important to appreciate that commercially, you know, these things then have big implications in terms of companies being able to take over and, you know, develop technologies that are discovered in academic laboratories, but then apply them in all sorts of different ways.
Dr. Tsao, I think you wanted to respond to that too.
Well, totally agree with my colleagues, and the particularly emphasizing support for basic research, because if you think about this technology, it was done in bacteria, and without the thinking of application human, and look where it is today. And we can count so many important breakthroughs that can come this way. So the ability to support fundamental basic research is critically important. Also, I think along the issues about saving human lives, creating jobs, is our global competitiveness situation. We are truly concerned that we don't continue this level of investment, that U.S. becomes less competitive than many other countries which are investing heavily into basic and translational research.
Thank you. Dr. McNally, in your testimony, you mentioned how these technologies may be able to be used in somatic or mature cells to treat and potentially cure diseases such as sickle cell anemia and muscular dystrophy. Can you please elaborate on this possibility, and what is that range of therapies and cures that we might only imagine?
I think it's widely anticipated that sickle cell will be one of the first things that's cured by this, where you could take a cell out because it's a bone marrow cell. You could correct it with CRISPR-Cas and return that person's bone marrow cell so that it's not a transplant situation. You're returning their own cells to them. And that's ongoing right now, and I anticipate that we will see that. For my field, I work in muscle diseases. Duchenne muscular dystrophy is a very challenging area, and right now we're looking at technologies where we're taking small antisense compounds where we would have to treat that individual for a lifetime every day with those compounds. Again, if we could get the cells, correct them, and reinsert them back in, that would be a one-time treatment and a lifetime treatment for that individual. So I think we're seeing a few examples where it's definitely heading that direction.
Thank you so much. Madam Chair, I yield back.
Thank you. Now recognize Mr. Palmer for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Several folks have mentioned the research on stem cell. Dr. Tim Towns at UAB is a very good friend of mine and doing world-class research in that area. I've got just a few questions. Dr. Zhao and Dr. Khan, the United States and Europe have often disagreed on regulations and policies in other areas of biotechnology, for example, genetically modified organisms. How does that impact international scientific cooperation, and do you anticipate a similar challenge in human gene editing?
Well, the intention is that when you get scientists, regulators, ethicists together from different countries, I think responsible individuals would begin to talk about what would be responsible behavior. That, I believe, is a starting point. And I do agree with you that we have some differences in the regulation. But I think overall, in the issue we talked about today, which is the application in germline gene editing, I have a sneaky suspicion, although I don't want to fully predict this until the work is done, there's great agreement about the concern about creating successive generations of individuals whose genes been altered. So I have a feeling that we actually will get agreement, if not harmonization, of many of these thoughts, and certainly it's our hope that we'll reach that in our initiative.
There are current regulations that prohibit federal funding for human for research on human embryos, and the FDA must issue an investigational new drug application before a biological product may be used in humans. Do you think these kind of safeguards are adequate to prevent the kind of experiments that we're concerned about?
Well, I'd like Jeff to answer this as well, because, as you heard, he's in the midst of leading one of our initiatives on mitochondrial DNA replacement. Mm-hmm. But I think we very much look into what is the right regulatory framework, particularly for issues like this. And I would say that, and of course he would have an opinion, but my feeling is that there's work need to be done to get better clarity about when and how we would regulate some of these areas.
Dr. Khan.
Thank you. In answer to your question, I think that the FDA will play a critical role, and although it will only play its role towards the end of the story. So the very basic research will be done prior to anybody thinking about an IND application or introducing it into a therapeutic context. And so we need to think about the entire translational pipeline, as it were, and all of the issues that will arise along the way and make sure that we have appropriate oversight for each of them. The FDA is clearly thinking about the issues that you are and are trying to figure out how their framework ought to apply. So first in human applications effectively, and then once something is licensed, how to control its use and dispersal. So one of the things that we all worry about is the so-called off-label use of a new technology. So even though the FDA may approve it only for a limited purpose, once it's licensed, it's hard to control. The FDA has some new tools that may actually make that more feasible to do, and I think as we get closer to the kinds of technologies we're discussing entering the therapeutic marketplace, that there will be stronger safeguards in place.
Well, with these safeguards, and staying on that line of thought, is there any worry that if the United States doesn't use this research that we could fall behind our international competition, and you know, could new regulations of this technology in the U.S. put our researchers at a disadvantage or cause them to move their research overseas? Dr. Khan?
I'll let Dr. Zhao and others speak to this, too, but there always is talk about that, and, of course, it became a bigger issue when the stem cell research, human embryonic stem cell research field really began to grow. And there are now international stem cell research societies which try to address issues that are clearly not governed by borders. And what we don't want, of course, is to have people who are doing the best science in the world think about leaving this country because it's easier to do elsewhere. So we need appropriate controls, but not those that squelch the science. Finding that sweet spot, of course, is the challenge.
One last question, and you can follow up on that and as you answer this also, but do you believe that we'll be able to get China and the United Kingdom and these other nations to work together to influence Asia and Europe to adopt similar standards, similar safeguards?
Maybe Dr. Zhao can speak to that, if that's okay.
Well, we're starting with getting the major scientists and academies involved. So we are the National Academy of Science and Medicine in the United States. We have the Chinese Academy of Science, where you would think that they have tremendous influence on the way the conduct of science is being carried out. We have the Royal Society, and we intend to include many international bodies. So I think the starting point clearly is where the scientists think what would be the right thing to do. One can imagine that we may have to escalate this conversation further depending on our findings. I just want to point out the question that you asked, which is the regulation aspect of this. In fact, you know, we do need a lot more clarity in this country. We haven't talked about the use of gene editing in non-human cells, plants, insects, and those changes, those science is already ongoing. We are producing possibly new species that will turn around much faster because of much shorter cycle time, reproductive time. So that regulation also has to come in to say what, in fact, is considered safe and what's considered as environmentally sound. And in fact, the National Academy is also looking at a study, looking at this issue. And as you know, in this country, USDA and FDA are involved with animal and plant regulation. So we also trying to give the right recommendation to fortify our regulatory processes. The final question you asked earlier about what the right thing to do is, I think from our perspective, National Academy, I think our first issue is human protection and doing the right thing for our society. I understand, of course, the potential loss of scientists, et cetera, but I do think that we have to actually take the high road to say what's right for us first, and I have a feeling everything else would follow and fall in the right place.
Thank you. Thank you, Madam Chairman.
And I now recognize Mr. Swalwell for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Madam Chair, and thank you to our panelists. My first question relates to something that a number of the members have brought up, which is it seems that America and our investments in federally funded research have been in decline. And as a result, our successes have been in decline, and our ability to attract and recruit and retain some of the best and brightest scientists may be in decline. So let's just, for argument's sake, go back to 1995. I was 14 years old, and the Human Genome Project was just starting to get off the ground, and many great results came out of that. That was 20 years ago. Would each witness just say, more or less, has America and its have you seen the investments that we've made as far as federally funded research, has that made America more or less exceptional in this field? So just tell me, more or less, and I'll start with Dr. Zhao. Just one word.
More.
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 So I'm confused because each of you has said that our investments have been on the decline, and so you're telling me that we actually have made more investments since 1995, and you believe we are more exceptional now in these fields?
You picked 1995.
But comparing...
If you said 1995 to 2005, we would say more. If you would say 2005 to 2015, we would all say less.
Is that right? Less, Dr. Zhao? Dr. Doudna? Dr. McNally? Dr. Khan? Okay, so that was my question. You would agree that we have become less exceptional in the field of genetic engineering as far as it relates to human DNA since 1995? That we've been on the
2005.
Decline? 2005 is the point, Dr. McNally?
Yeah.
So what's exciting about this research in this field is the potential for us to conquer diseases before they conquer us. And I look at the example of Huntington disease, which affects anywhere from 30,000 to 200,000 people. And it's a disease that is so cruel, it steals your memory and affects your muscular system. And I'm just wondering, maybe if Dr. Doudna could tell us and have others weigh in, what can the U.S. do specifically to take leadership in this area if we have the appropriate funding so that we can conquer these diseases?
So I think, you know, again, sort of maybe echoing something that I mentioned earlier and that has been discussed here, I think, you know, the U.S. has been a real leader in basic research for a while. And all of us are concerned that we see that edge slipping away over time. And so I think that, you know, the investment in fundamental research that will allow scientists to understand, for example, genome engineering technology like we're discussing today, how does it operate, how can we deliver it to patients, how do we ensure that it's operating as we intend and not creating unintended consequences, that it's safe, that it's effective. All of those lines of research are going to require, I would say, a combination of efforts by people like me that do basic research and people like my colleagues who are medical doctors and think about clinical issues. We need to be putting our efforts together, and that has to be, I think, supported by federal funds.
And how can we tell the story to the American people who look to us as a Congress to make the decisions when it comes to funding with so many competing priorities? How can we tell them that something like a dollar invested in basic research, where you may not be able to tell us what disease you're going to be able to cure 10 to 15 years from now, but there's still the taxpayer is looking to us to, you know, hold accountable the funding. Like, how can we better tell the story as a science community about what we could see from this down the road and how we could truly, you know, attack and cure some of these diseases? I think that's probably one of the biggest challenges. And maybe Dr. McNally.
Yeah, I mean, we've seen incredible advances that have come out of basic research. And I'll talk about my field, which is cardiology. It was out of basic research of understanding the LDL receptor that led to statins, the drugs that probably a lot of people in this room take. And we've seen a direct translation to a reduction in the rate of heart attacks. I mean, it's a very different world than what it was when I first started my training 20 years ago. We don't see acute heart attacks like we used to. And that came as an outcome of basic research not that many years ago. So we can tell the same story for heart disease. We can tell the same story for many cancers. Cancer and heart disease are the major things that kill people. So we've made huge headway in that.
Great. Thank you. And, you know, I know every member up here has thousands of people in their district who go to bed on their knees praying that people like you will make discoveries that will make them or their relatives live healthier lives. So thank you for what you're doing, and hopefully we can do the right thing here and better fund your initiatives. And I yield back.
Thank you. And I now recognize Mr. Westerman for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Madam Chairman, and thank you, panel, for your invigorating testimony. Dr. Zell, what's your anticipated timeline for the initiative on human gene editing?
We are convening a international summit in the fall or late fall, and that should be a really important meeting that will get together international scientists. As you heard from our previous experience at Asiloma in the 1970s, one would engage in the discussions that Dr. Doudna and McNally and Khan put forth, and hopefully that the findings of that meeting will be published very shortly after that. Perhaps equally important is a concurrent deep dive study, which we are conducting, that will involve analysis, research, the assessment of risk benefits, as well as a regulatory framework and ethical issues. And that usually, what we call a consensus report, would take as long as about a year, although we're hoping that we will try to move it faster for exactly the reasons that we've been talking about. Such a report with very specific recommendations, which we're willing to put forward under both public hearing and also close discussions, will be available to you, to the nation, and to many others. So I could say the time frame is late fall to sometime next year, and hopefully as early as we possibly can to put out that report.
So how great are your concerns that the initiative may not be able to keep up with the breakneck speed of the technology as it moves forward?
Right. This is exactly why we need a summit, a meeting first, where key scientists, and we're going to engage a large number, will discuss about what would be considered as good conduct, good oversight, understanding risk, et cetera, so that the scientific community, which is really driving most of this research, understands those issues and have, in general, agreement. We also believe, of course, in our study itself, that becomes a definitive document by which you and others can be informed to say what are the right decisions based on consensus.
So you said the scientific community is driving the research. As the national academies work on the new initiatives towards building the framework, do you believe the scientific community will embrace and voluntarily follow the guidelines, or will there need to be regulations or laws put in place?
Well, you know, as you already heard, I think there are many responsible scientists, particularly the ones who are leading this field, who feel already that we should, you know, put a moratorium and not slow it down. So I do believe that already going into this meeting, although there may be many different opinions, there's probably general agreement that we need to slow down this area until we have a much clearer point of view about where we should be going and the clarity in terms of regulation. The problem I'm concerned about is that if we rush into this too fast, we don't really want to, in such an important issue, we've got to be very thoughtful. That being said, we understand the time urgency of the situation.
Right, and the advisory group to the initiative that was named yesterday, it includes scientists and researchers from China and the United Kingdom. Do you believe these participants will help influence Asia and Europe to adopt similar standards?
We certainly hope so, and in fact, that was only an advisory group. Our intention is that in the international summit, we include a lot more scientists from Asia and every part of the world, Europe, et cetera, to be part of this discussion. You know, it's interesting when we think back on U.S. position. You know, when the Sillimar conference came about, the U.S. was the main show in town in biotechnology. So among the U.S. scientists, you can imagine there's an agreement, you know, so there's a general way of saying, you know, what do we do next? Here we really need to include international scientists.
So what capacity and infrastructure does the Chinese government have in place for regulating human scientific research?
You know, I'm not that familiar with the regulation at this point in China. As you heard from my colleague, Dr. Khan, there's several speculation about what's there, what's not there. I think we would hope that that meeting will bring out with clarity what each country's position is, what's the regulatory position, what's the scientific position, so that we can all come together, examine this together.
Thank you, and I believe I'm out of time, Madam Chair.
Great, thank you. And I now recognize Mr. Foster.
Thank you, Madam Chair. In addition to the international summit that you're having this fall, it strikes me that a full-blown National Academy study may have merit to do a deeper dive into this. So Dr. Zoutwood, a letter signed by members of Congress, for example, help you in recruiting assistance for this sort of effort?
I think it would be outstanding, in fact, if we get a letter from Congress on this. We took this upon ourselves as a National Academy because that's what we do. And we know it's the right thing to do. We have support of scientists and others to say go forward. But I think it would be tremendously impactful if Congress will provide us with the kind of support and mandate to go forward with this.
Okay. Just a quick question. What's the rough cost and time to get a mouse model with a specific genetic modification? Does anyone? Just roughly, you know, within a factor or two. You know, is it $10,000 or $5,000?
Yeah. Well, with CRISPR-Cas initiated, you're probably decreased the cost in half and decreased the time in half.
So if it was 25,000, it's probably closer to 10 now, and if it was a year, it's probably closer to 6 months. That's counting breeding time.
Well, when it seems that one of the things slowing down the application of this is a lot of sort of two classes of worries about potential dangers. The first is so-called off-target effects, where in addition to the genetic modification you want, you get inadvertent modifications to the genome. And it's my understanding that the technology is evolving rapidly, and that I was just wondering if I'll ask you to go out on a limb, I guess, and Dr. Doudna first, about, you know, if you just look at the rate of progress on this, what is the rough time scale where we can expect, where we might expect you'll be in a position that it could be used, you know, quote unquote, safely on humans?
Well, I think one has to sort of distinguish what types of applications we're talking about. I think if we're considering application to treat a disease like sickle cell anemia, where the editing could be done on cells that are taken out of a patient and then validated before they're reintroduced into the body, I feel that that is likely to happen, you know, in the next year or two. Honestly, I think it's moving.
So no technological development there.
No, because I think we already have the ability to, you know, validate that correct sequencing was editing was done by DNA sequencing in that sort of a scenario. I think if you're talking about an application like where you want to introduce the tool into a patient's body and where you want editing to occur in the body, then that's farther off. First of all, we don't have the very good ways to introduce this into specific tissue types yet, and also we don't have good ways to validate that the correct type of editing was done without off-target effects, as you implied. But I think for any kinds of applications where we can do the validation outside of the body, that's going to move forward in the next year or two.
Okay, and then if I raise the stakes further to germline editing, is that something that may just never happen? It may never be reliable enough, or is it a reasonable guess that within the next 5 years that you'll be able to validate the germline edit has taken place correctly and with high enough confidence that?
Well, I'm very interested to hear my colleague's answer to that question, but I guess my answer would be that it will depend on the way that research is enabled around, you know, that sort of application. I think if it's possible to do experiments in germ cells so that we can understand how this technology works, operates in those types of cells, then I think, you know, boy, it's always hard to put a timeline on things, but, you know, certainly within a few years, it'll probably be to the point where one could, you know, employ it for that sort of application, but I don't know if my colleagues would agree with that or not.
I agree. I think that's a reasonable timeline, 5-10 years, if you had to guess.
Well, I'm trying to, you know, get some idea what the response time from Congress and our society has to be for that. There's a second class of potential dangers having to do with just misunderstandings about what the effects of a specific genetic change will be on the characteristics of the adult organism. And, you know, over the spread of different things from simple conditions like sickle cell to complex things like, you know, personality. You know, what is your guess for the time scale that we are looking at there from right now to never?
My answer is certainly much longer. I think that to me, that's not limited by the genome editing technology as much as it's limited by our knowledge of the human genome.
Okay, thank you. Timer has gone down. I yield back.
Thank you. I now recognize Dr. Abraham.
Well, after I read y'all's testimony last night, went online and read each of y'all's bios, your parents must be very proud. We all in this room, I think, understand the potential that this type of research can lead to, not only in the human endeavors, but in plant technology, curing world hunger. So it is applicable to so many aspects of humanity, and to, I think it was Dr. your point, Dr. McNally, that it probably would be unethical if we have a child with sickle cell MD, ALL, and this therapy is available, not to offer it. Dr. Dowd and I salute your intelligence for recognizing, even though I know you aren't particularly looking for the CRISPR-Cas9 technology, that you recognize it. And I compared it last night. I was reading to Fleming discovering penicillin. But I think maybe this CRISPR can save as millions of lives as penicillin has. So kudos to you guys for what you do. I guess the question I'm leading up to, the old adage, if you get two doctors in a room, you get three different opinions, is we know very true, certainly on my end of the stick. And Dr. Downey, you published, I think, a article in the Science magazine that you wanted this moratorium, and Dr. Zhao, you've been pushing for it. Are you guys getting some pushback from members of your community that says, you know, no, we don't need a moratorium, and let this thing go, let this genie out of the bottle, and don't put it back in?
Well, just I can answer, tell you what I'm seeing. I think that, you know, at this around the same time that we published the perspective in Science magazine, a related perspective was published in Nature magazine from a different group that actually called for, I would say, a real moratorium, even on research. So that group basically was advocating not proceeding with any kind of research on human germ cells using genome editing technology. And I just want to point out that in the group that I met with in January, we actually discussed that and felt that actually we, in our opinion, research on those types of cells appropriately regulated should be enabled, just not clinical application.
Dr. Zahn, when you had the, I think it was back in 1975, I was reading last night, y'all had a recombinant DNA moratorium that you tried to put forth voluntarily. In the international community, was that followed? Has that been pretty much adhered to throughout the last few generations?
So a little bit before my time, but it's a landmark in the area of science policy, in that it was a voluntary moratorium instituted by the scientific community. The truth is, we haven't seen anything like that since. It was a very important undertaking, and I think when the scientific community got together to talk about the implications of recombinant DNA technology at that time, they weren't sure whether the scientific community would follow what the
much like now.
It's 40 years later, and the scientific community is very different today than it was in 1975.
For sure.
So we were indisputably the leaders in the world of that science in 1975. As everybody has said, the technology now is much more widespread and much easier to implement, as Dr. Downa has said, making it much more difficult for any one community of scientists to actually speak on behalf of the whole.
We think we can probably say realistically that America will lead in the discussion of the ethical and moral applications of this. But to follow up with your statement then, as Americans or as the United States scientific community, if we should see an element get outside the bounds, can we do anything?
Yeah, it's a great question. And as I said in my testimony and in my statement that you read and I reiterated today, the journal publication community has a very important role to play here. Your research doesn't really mean much unless your peers have reviewed it, called it good, and then it gets published in a credible place. So that's an important barrier. That doesn't mean people won't try to do things that are unethical and then try to get them published, but it has a sort of strong inoculating feature, I would say. The other thing that Dr. Downa pointed out, but I'll reiterate, is that there's been a little bit of a disagreement in the scientific community on the topic of gene editing, about whether there should be a moratorium only on clinical application or on something more widespread. And so that's a healthy debate to have, and it's great that we're having it, and it's great the academies are bringing it to the international level. So that's exactly the discussion we ought to be having. One last thing I'll say is that people around the world want to be part of the scientific community. There's a very strong incentive for them to behave, right, to follow the conventions, which make them a legitimate member. And I think we shouldn't underestimate the power of that. So, yeah, there might be fewer restrictions in other parts of the world, but those people want to publish in Science and Nature just like American scientists do.
Okay. Thank you. Mr. Chairman, I yield back.
Thank you. I now recognize Mr. Sherman.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, for holding these hearings. This has been an an area of intense interest on my part since the year 2000, when I went to the floor and said that the most important decision we will make this century is whether our successor species is carbon-based or silicon-based, whether the new and intelligent species on this planet is the product of genetic engineering or the product of computer engineering. Some of you will remember I served on this committee in the 107th and 108th Congresses, and this was pretty much my main reason for serving on the Science Committee. I should bring to the attention of this subcommittee that on June 19, 2008, transcript available, the relevant Subcommittee of Foreign Affairs had a hearing titled Genetic and Other Human Modification Technologies, Sensible International Regulation, or a New Kind of Arms Race. And in fact, the analogy to what we're talking about here is the only other technology that was equally explosive, perhaps, and that is nuclear weapons technology. In 1939, Albert Einstein wrote to Roosevelt saying what was possible, and policymakers had only 6 years before that technology literally exploded onto the scene. Thank God we've got a little bit more time. But the Non-Proliferation Treaty took many decades after 1939 or after 1945, and I think could be a good model for what we need here. Dr. Khan, it may be too long a list, but I don't know whether America is exactly number one in this technology or whether Britain or China might be slightly ahead, but we're all within, I think, a few years. But there are a whole bunch of other countries either at that level or maybe 4 or 5 years behind. Can you even list the countries that within 5 years could be where we are now?
I don't know.
Are we talking a dozen, two dozen?
I'm not sure that it's that I or anybody could do that. And in fact, I'm not sure that it even requires countries. It's individuals who have access to the capacity, which, as Dr. Doudna has said, is actually fairly democratic, I think was a term that she used. So in a way, you know, it's about where people have the laboratory capacity, and that could be almost anywhere in the world.
Thank God nuclear weapons take an industrial scale, and although they reflect only 1945 technology, we've seen in Iran that you have to do something big, you have to spend billions of dollars, it has to be visible to the world that you're doing something. You seem to be saying that what we're concerned about here could be a lot cheaper and take place in a laboratory basement?
And I'll let my colleagues speak to the concrete answer to that question, but I think exactly that kind of point is really important for how we think about what appropriate oversight, regulation, guidelines need to be.
And I want to pick up on Mr. Foster's question about time frame, but one of the concerns we will have is that countries will see this as, oh my God, it might be terribly unethical, but it gives us a leg up militarily or economically. Damn the torpedoes. Leaving aside engineering intelligence and looking to things that would affect a soldier. A soldier's a little better if they've got courage, stamina, and strength. We're already at a point where drugs are going to be used by various militaries to impart those characteristics to their soldiers. But then we could go further to genetic engineering. What is the time frame before there's genetic engineering that would do the simplest of, I don't know which of those three is easiest, would give a soldier either more strength or more stamina, or I'll say more courage, more willingness to charge out. Is there any way to say that soldier is 5 years from now, 15 years from now, or are we in the world of science fiction? Anybody venture a guess? Okay. Well, we'll be in a position, I think, next decade where at least, well, already many militaries are using drugs on their soldiers, and then the next step will be to use the next element of medical technology, not drugs, but genetic engineering. Does anyone have, I mean, we're the first and most ethical use of this technology is to remedy maladies. The next step will be to allow parents to have kids that have all the best characteristics of anyone in their family or in the world. And then we'll go to giving kids unprecedented capacities. And at that point, we're talking maybe human, maybe transhuman. Does anyone here have any view as to how long it will be before we can affect the intelligence of either people, either adults or of germ cell, the germline?
I'll dive
Dr. McNally's coming
in.
Close.
I'll dive in. As Dr. Downes said, the limitations of engineering things like intelligence mm-hmm. are far more limited by our genetic observations mm-hmm. than they are by our capacity to do genome engineering. We have actually very large-scale genetic projects ongoing right now. The 1,000 Genomes Project in the next year or two will be looking at 1 million human sequences and a lot of information connected to it. And the simple answer is that traits like intelligence are not single mm-hmm. gene they're yeah. probably not even entirely genetic, is what people are referring to on a regular basis right now. There are a whole series of articles written about the missing heritability for many different traits, things that we thought were genetic when it turns out we look at the genes, they may not be so genetic, or they are very high complexity.
So the technology, it's interesting, because in nuclear weapons, there's two components. One is weaponizing the highly enriched uranium, which turns out to be the easy part. It seems the most dangerous. Oh, my God, you're going to turn it into a nuclear weapon. The real hard part and the decider as to which countries have nuclear weapons technology is the ability to enrich uranium.
The gentleman's time is.
It seems like what you're describing is a situation where the roadmap to what genes do have what characteristics is the hard part and the part that will determine, and the actual snipping and replacing and editing, you guys have that down. I yield back.
Thank you, Ms. Bonamici.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman, and thank you to the chairman and ranking member for holding this hearing about this important topic. And my absence from most of the hearing was only because I was in another hearing. It does not indicate my lack of interest in the subject, and I'm really glad that we have this, I agree, very incredibly qualified panel, and I especially appreciate the gender diversity as someone who works on education issues and trying to get more women in STEM. Thank you for having a balanced panel. So I missed a lot of the questions have already been asked, but there's a couple of things I wanted to follow up on. There's been a lot of attention on using gene editing technologies in human embryos, and of course, with the press from what happened in China, that's getting attention. But I know that a lot of the research is not in human embryos. So could you discuss how the technologies are being used in research today in other areas, including in organisms other than humans? And also, can you talk about the potential promise from sectors other than healthcare, energy, for example?
Okay, well, I can take a stab at that. So you're absolutely right that the technology is being widely employed in many different kinds of cells and organisms. And I'll just give you a couple of examples. I think that in plant biology, this is going to be equally impactful as the kind of applications that we're talking about here in human health, in terms of enabling very widespread introduction of genes into plants that could be beneficial, especially for dealing with climate change and other kinds of environmental impacts in plants. And I'm not a plant biologist, but I'm saying this based on conversations I've had with people that are already doing those kinds of experiments and are extremely excited about the way that research has been enabled. And then you mentioned biofuels, and I think that's very interesting because I'm aware of several groups that are actually using this kind of genome engineering for what we call systems biology, basically being able to make large-scale changes in the genomes of organisms that will be useful for producing various kinds of chemicals, including biofuels and other very important materials that can be difficult to obtain in other ways.
Terrific. And I know Dr. Zhao wants to.
This, in fact, is a very important area. Today, we talk about human genome editing, but I'm glad you raised the question about the usage in other living organisms. Mr. Sherman asked about, what will be the misuse, if you will. Well, we do have to think about, the use in plants, insects, et cetera. What happens if there's misuse? And what would happen to the environmental impact? And who actually gets to decide who's going to do what? And there are more commercial sources, I believe, opportunity for commercialization in changing coffee beans or whatever that you can imagine. So this is an area that, in fact, called gene drive, that, again, national academies are looking very carefully at this and how to regulate this. So I do think this is, to me, a very important area, even though our focus today is on human gene editing.
Terrific. And I'm going to slightly change the topic. Dr. Downdet, did I say your name properly?
Yes.
I know you co-founded several startup companies, and we've had conversations in this committee before about the challenges in trying to launch companies, but also transferring academic research into the marketplace. So can you chat a little bit about that and what the challenges have been and what the federal government can do to help with transferring academic research into the marketplace?
Yeah, this is a very important area, and I'm a real newbie to it. This is actually the first time that research in my lab has led to something that, had clear commercial applications. So I can tell you my experience, being involved in starting companies and raising money for companies. We've had different experiences, I would say. I've been involved in three different startups around this technology so far. And I've had a lot of help with one of them in particular through a biomedical research initiative in the Bay Area that was actually funded in part by the state of California. Mm-hmm. And what that does is to give people like me who know nothing about starting a business some training. We got access to some legal advice early on. I think this institute paid for the incorporation of a company initially, and then gave us some support in terms of writing for federal funding for the company. I think this kind of support is really important. And as I talk to my colleagues around the country who are trying to do similar things, commercializing work coming out of their academic labs, I hear over and over how all of us who are in the academic world could really benefit from that kind of level of support. I'm not sure if it's something that happens at the federal level or if it's better done lower down. It's hard to say.
Thank you so much. My time has expired. I yield back, Mr. Chairman. Thank you.
Thank you. Now I want to recognize Mr. Palmer.
A couple of quick questions. Most of this discussion, I think, has been about government research. You're talking about convening an international summit. I just want to make sure that when we're talking about implementing safeguards, that this includes the private sector, that they're not running out there as mavericks. Is that correct?
Certainly our intention, if you look carefully at the way we put our advisory committee together, we have people who have great industry experience on it, and our intention is to include industry and people in the commercial sector to be in this discussion.
Thank you. I yield to balance my time, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. I now recognize Mr. Foster.
Thank you. It's my understanding that very often there's a computing bottleneck in our ability to analyze genomes. And I guess, Dr. McNally, can you tell me about some of the committee? Can you tell the committee about some of the work you've done at Argonne, which is a facility shared by the ranking member and myself?
Yeah, so right now, it's since more than a year and a half, it's been very possible to sequence a human genome with the consumable cost being about $1,000, which is an amazingly low price for a single genome. That doesn't include the cost of analysis. And so the real rate-limiting step right now is the time it takes to analyze genomes. So what we've done is we've actually, working together with Argonne National Labs, University of Chicago, and now Northwestern, we've actually taken a Cray XE6 supercomputer that's at Argonne and outfitted it with all the computing code that's available through the Broad Institute so that we can now, for example, analyze 250 genomes in a weekend if they give us the whole machine to work. So that dramatically accelerates our ability to screen through 3 billion bases of an individual genome and score its 4 million differences that exist in each one of those genomes, the vast majority of which are rare and private.
And well, thank you. That's very interesting. I guess another application of federal investments that are having an unintended benefit. I guess for Dr. Khan, has anyone ever taken the bull by the horns and actually attempted to draft legislation or international treaties, you know, at regulating human genetic engineering or other genetic engineering in the environment?
That's a good question. I don't know that there have been legislation or, you know, bills proposed, and I don't know about international treaties. There certainly have been efforts to craft guidelines, but they're non-binding by entities like the World Health Organization or the World Medical Association, which has crafted actually fairly well-known guidelines on human subjects research called Declaration of Helsinki, which tends to be followed but in a voluntary way and then built into regulation at the national level. But I don't think that there has been any successful international regulation.
All right, or even proposed just, you know, list enumeration of all of the issues that you'll have to resolve when you write rules.
Yeah, I'm not aware, although I'm not a historian of science. That's a really interesting question that I, maybe I'll do some looking and see if I can get back to you.
No, I appreciate that.
Sure.
And do you understand right now, if you're on a hospital ship in international waters, who's the regulator?
That's the right kind of question to be asking. And this sort of issue came up when there was a supposed cloning of a human being. You may remember back in whenever that was, the late 90s, early 2000s. Which, not to be a hoax, but one of the claims was it was being done in international waters and out of the reach of any of the national regulations or governance structure, which, you know, in a way was a helpful aha moment, right? You need to think about what to do when all you need is a well-fitted ship that has the laboratory on board and you're outside of the any restrictions that an international treaty or a national government might employ.
And I guess one last question. The issue of gene drives has entered the news in interesting ways with the potential to sort of take over the genome of entire species in the wild in the course of, you know, a few dozens of generations. And so this obviously has huge environmental effects and has to be internationally regulated, presumably, because of, you know, insects don't normally, you know, obey national borders. And so I was just wondering if that is an area where, for example, this committee might interestingly have a separate branch of investigation, that all of the applications of this technology to plants and animals in the wild and in the laboratory. Yes, Dr. Zal.
Mr. Fawcett, as I mentioned, I think the National Academies is undertaking such a study. We'll be happy to send you all the materials. And in fact, as we look at what we are potentially covering or not covering, we can have a conversation about what else should be done.
Okay. And so the charge is complete for the study, or is it ongoing? All right. I'd appreciate that. Thank you. I yield back.
Thank you. And I'd like to thank our witnesses for the testimony today. Outstanding. And all the members for the questions. The record will remain open for 2 weeks for additional comments and written questions from members. The witnesses are excused, and this hearing is adjourned.
Thank you.